Morning, everyone. It's so great to be here today. Thank you so much, Brookfield Zoo, the Chicago Zoological Society, and the Wildlife Conservation Network for bringing us here today to Chicago to talk about our lion conservation efforts in Samburu in northern Kenya. Our project is called Ewaso Lions, named after this great, beautiful river that snakes throughout northern Kenya. It's called the Ewaso Nyiro River, and our work focuses along this whole river ecosystem, looking at the lion population and seeing how they're faring. We work in an unfenced area. We work outside protected areas where lions and the local people share the same landscape. The number of lions we're currently monitoring is over 300, a crucial population in Kenya and the third largest. We work across two counties, Samburu and Laikipia, both in the northern part of the country. So why is lion conservation, why is it such a critical issue, and why are we all doing it? Why are we talking about it? Why are we based in northern Kenya looking at lion populations? The reason is lions, unfortunately, are in serious trouble. That's the reality. There has been a 90% drop in lion numbers in Africa just in the last 75 years. The current estimate is approximately 30,000 lions in the whole continent. That's a very, very small number. In my country, Kenya, we only have about 2,000 lions. This is a huge concern. It's a huge concern for the government of Kenya, the tourism industry. People from all over the world come to Kenya to see lions, and conservationists such as ourselves who are trying to protect them, but watch, see their numbers plummeting so quickly. So this is definitely a concern, and this is why we are talking about lion conservation and why it's such a critical issue. What's happening? Why are lions disappearing so quickly? Unfortunately, the biggest reason is habitat loss, as it is for so many wildlife species. Lions are running out of space. There's just not enough land available for them. Places they used to once roam in are disappearing so quickly. With more people, especially coming up to northern Kenya, more development, more pressures put on lions, they're just not able to roam like they used to. This is what's happening. They just can't move. They're now becoming more and more confined to isolated, protected areas. What happens when lions are under so much pressure? They come into contact with the local communities. I am very fortunate to work with the Samburu people, whose lives, their livelihoods depend on their livestock. Their cows, their camels, their donkeys, their goats, they're everything to the Samburu people. But when a lion comes along and it's looking for food and it can't find any, unfortunately, it tends to target cows, which are easy prey. And what happens when it attacks a cow? The local people will get very angry, understandably. They've just lost their livelihood because the lions have killed them. There's a lot of anger and resentment that builds up. And lions are unfortunately then killed in retaliation. In northern Kenya, lions are shot, speared, and poisoned at times. So for these two reasons, this is why lions are disappearing. Loirish was a lion who moved into Samburu in 2008. As you can see, he's pretty maneless, which is quite common for lions in northern Kenya because of the conditions, the arid landscape. He was this amazing male, very famous. His name means strong, brave warrior in the local Samburu language. He was the father of many cubs. He had control over two prides in Samburu and Buffalo Springs. He really was very famous, together with his brother. His brother is called Gret, which means coward in the Samburu language. We named him Coward because it was always Loirish who would make the first move, and Gret would always hang back and then decide, would follow what his brother would do. Unfortunately, 2 years ago, exactly 2 years ago, Loirish started getting into a lot of trouble. He was going out of the safety of Samburu, he was going out of the park, and he was going straight to the villages. And every night, together with his brother, he was killing camels. And over 3 months, these two male lions caused so much destruction in this one village. They killed 10 camels just in 3 months. Of course, that village was very angry. They had lost everything. We heard about this, and at this point, this village was in an area that we were not really working in. And we said, we're going to have to be careful here. We need to be a bit more proactive and really monitor Loirish's movements. So what we did is we attached a GPS radio collar on Loirish to really try and understand how he was going out of the parks, what he was doing, when was he going to the villages. We would get hourly locations of his movements. And this was fantastic. Now we could really keep an eye on him. This young warrior you can see in this picture, his name is Latoye. He's only 20 years old, but his job was to look after Loirish, track him, go out, and make sure that every time Loirish was heading out of the park, he would go ahead to the village and say, Loirish is on his way out. And you need to protect your livestock. You need to look after your camels so he doesn't come and attack them. Unfortunately, a year and a half ago, Loirish was shot dead. His head was cut off and burnt. His legs were also cut and his skin was removed. And this is the reality of what happens with lions in Kenya and the African continent. We were devastated when this happened. Our team, our project, we really felt the loss of such a famous lion that we knew so well and had monitored for so many years. But what was absolutely amazing was the response we got from the community. We had people from all over Samburu calling us, radioing us, sending us text messages, showing up in camp saying, we're so sorry Loirish is dead. We're so sorry he was shot. We can't believe he's no longer with us. This was the first time we had ever known the Samburu community coming to apologize for the loss of a lion. And we realized something at this point. Although devastating for our team, especially Latoye, who sat in camp with his head in his hands, just saying, they've killed my lion, they've killed my lion. He said that every day for weeks. It took him ages to recover. Despite that, despite the feelings we had about, you know, losing such an amazing lion, we were overwhelmed with the support we got from the community. And this showed us that something is working. Something is working in the areas we are really focusing on and operating in. The community, for them to come to our camp and say, sorry about losing a lion, clearly something's working. And it's up to us now to take what's working, take it to the place where Loirish was shot. And that's exactly what we've done. So what's been working? Our flagship program is a program called Warrior Watch. A warrior is a young Samburu man, aged between 15 to 25, whose role in his community is really looking after his livestock, maintaining security for his family, for his village. And he spends a lot of time out in the bush. When he's out, he's seeing wildlife. Warriors are there every day seeing wildlife, whether it's by sight or tracks. Yet, they've never been involved in conservation. Yet, they're the ones who are seeing wildlife all the time, but no one has gone to them to bring them on board. And Jeneria, our field manager, who had been working with me for about 2 years at that point, said, you know, I'm a warrior, and now I'm involved in conservation. Why can't we bring more warriors involved? Why can't we bring them on board and get them to be real leaders and decision makers in conservation? So that's what we did in 2010. We started with 5 warriors who came on board, and their role is really to be conservation ambassadors, to go out, to monitor wildlife. They're in their villages, they see which predators are in their area. And also, if they know carnivores are in a specific place, they can alert the herders and say, don't take your goats in this area, the lions are there. We don't want conflict to happen. We don't want these goats to be killed. So take them elsewhere and really look after your goats because we know these carnivores are in the area. So they're great messengers. They really are the eyes and ears in the bush. They all have, the Samburu warriors have great belts and big knives. And now our team have little GPS units, tucked in with their knives, pens, and their little toothbrush from the toothbrush tree, and data sheets. And most of our guys now are filling out data sheets, telling us what they're seeing. This is fantastic, because we're getting all this great wildlife information, especially wildlife distribution numbers, and we've been able to see the change over time. So we asked the warriors, we said, what would you like in exchange for all this great wildlife information that you're giving us? And they said, we'd like to go to school. We've never been to school. We don't know how to read and write. As children, we looked after our livestock. Our fathers didn't let us go to school, so please teach us how to read and write. So what we did is, we said, that's easy to do. We'll start a Sunday school for you. And we started this school back in 2010. We started teaching the warriors the basics with the alphabet. And now, 5 years later, 12 of our warriors can read and write. And what's amazing is they're not just writing an animal's name and that's it. They're writing little stories. They're saying, we heard the wild dogs were in our village last night and we were communicating with the elders about the, you know, their presence. They're writing proper stories about what the wildlife situation in their area. It's really fantastic to see how far these young men have come along. We realized about 3 years ago that this program appeared to be working very well. And to really justify expanding it, which is really what was needed, we decided to evaluate Warrior Watch, which is very much part of our work, is evaluation to really see how things are working or not working. And the results were so positive. The evaluation results showed that not only had the community's attitudes towards carnivores been really improved as a direct result of the presence of the warriors, but also this program was very successful in the absence of monetary incentives. It was all about education, training, and awareness. This was so exciting for us, and we said, right, this is now the time for us to scale up this program. We now operate in 4 community conservancies in northern Kenya. We have 18 warriors working with us, with the vision of really growing this and having a network of warriors in the region. So word spread that the warriors are in school, the warriors are reading and writing, we're working with children, we're working with elders. So who comes along? Who comes along marching into our camp saying, where are we? Women. The women. And the women said, come on, we can get involved in conservation, in lion conservation. Teach us. We also want to go to school. We don't know how to read and write. Where's our school? And so it took us a while. It took us about a year or so to really develop how the ways we were going to work with the women from Samburu. And this really was the birth of our new program, which is called Mama Simba, meaning Mother of Lions. And of course, we said, all right, first thing we're going to do is start the school for you. So we started a Saturday school for the women. And the warriors are not going to be happy when I say this to you, but I will say it anyway. They picked up reading and writing within 6 months. And all of them were writing names down of all the animals, not just in English, but also Kiswahili. These Mama Simba women were just so passionate and so enthusiastic about getting involved in this program. This lady, she's very special. She was one of the leaders. She is one of the leaders of the Mama Simba program. Her name is Parasoroi, and she comes from the Sasab village, which is very close to our camp. And a few months ago, Parasoroi came to me and she said, I have 8 children, and they all go to school. I encourage them to go to school. Every day, my children would come back and show me their books and show me what they were learning in school. But I had no idea what they were showing me. I couldn't see their marks. I couldn't see what the teachers were saying. There was no way I knew what my children were showing me. Now, I can read. And now I can read what my children are doing in school. And this lets me encourage them. And this is the power of the Mama Simba group and the education program. We did some conservation training with the women. So we realized that they spend a lot of time in their villages, and we would like to try and understand carnivore presence when they come to the villages at night. And engaging the women was perfect in this. So we were showing them all the tracks, and we were trying to, you know, show them the differences between the leopard, lion, wild dog, hyena tracks. And they all said, you know, we're pretty good at this. The one thing is, though, we've never even seen these animals. We live here, right next to Samburu, the very famous wildlife park. We hear lions, we see hyena tracks outside our village, we hear the wild dogs calling in the distance, but we've never actually seen these animals. So show them to us. That's what they said to us. And we said, well, that's easy. We'll take you on safari. So here we were, we packed up all the women in four vehicles, and we took them into Samburu, which is just the most beautiful park. I'm a little biased, but it is the most beautiful park in the world, if you ask me. And so we took the women on, and by 11 o'clock, we'd actually seen very little in the morning. I think the highlight at that point was a crocodile. And the women, I could hear a lot of sort of grumbling at the back, saying, where are these famous lions of Samburu that she keeps going on about? And I said, okay, guys, I spoke to the other guys on the radios, and I said, we've got to find these lions. It's essential. So all of you spread out, just look for tracks, follow them, and let's find these lions. So that's exactly what we did. We all spread out, found the tracks, followed them, and came across two of Samburu's famous lions, Nanai and Nabalo. And what was really exciting, they had just killed a baboon and they were eating, and it was great action. So here the women were looking through the binoculars, very, very excited. Jeneria, who was in our small little Suzuki vehicle, the lady next to him, she had brought her little baby with her. And the baby was getting a little bit agitated, so Jeneria radioed me and he said, I'm gonna drive away because we don't wanna disturb the lions, so I'll just stay in touch with you on the radio. So he left, and the rest of us stayed with the lions. 10 minutes later, Jeneria calls me on the radio, and he's very calm, unlike me. And he says, Shivani, I think you should bring the ladies to where I am. And I said, why? Why are we gonna leave the lions? And he said, no, something really amazing's happening here. And I said, what, more lions? And he said, no, please just bring the ladies to Koitogo, which is this big famous hill in Samburu. And I said, all right, I'll bring them, but for what? And he said, well, you might want to come really quickly because an elephant's giving birth. And so I threw the radio down, told all the women to just get down and hang on, and and drove like crazy to get to this hill, Koitogo. And we did. We saw the birth of this little baby. And it was absolutely amazing. I've been in Samburu over 13 years, and I'd never seen it. Jeneria had never seen it. No one had ever seen it. And what was even more special is there's actually a story about Samburu women in particular and elephants. And this is the story. I'm going to give you a very short version of it. Long time ago, the Samburu elephants used to bring firewood for the Samburu ladies. And that would help the women with all their cooking and whatever they needed it for. But the women were never satisfied with the quantity of wood. So they would always tell the elephants, oh, this is not enough, go get us more. And that went on, and the elephants got so frustrated, they said, right, we're done. We're having nothing to do with you Samburu ladies anymore because you need too much more firewood than we can provide. And that broke the relationship. When this happened, the women in our vehicles started talking to the elephants in Samburu. And they were saying, we know our relationship's broken. We know that, you know, we're not the way we used to be. But we're so sorry because we know you're in trouble. They said, we know you're being killed for your tusks. We know that you have a lot of problems. And now we understand that. Here were these ladies in the vehicle talking to these elephants, talking to the mother of this little newborn. It was so amazing to have been there at this particular moment. But the problem is, as soon as we went back to the villages and our camp, word spread that we'd taken the women out and we'd seen an elephant give birth. So what happened? Of course, every single woman shows up saying, take us to the park so we can see an elephant give birth. And we said, well, that's not really possible. It's a very, very rare thing. Anyway, it was an incredible moment, and what a great way to start off our Mama Simba program. Another activity that we've involved the Mama Simba women in is a litter campaign, cleaning up all the plastic litter that we have in Samburu. It's a huge problem in Kenya. We cannot afford to lose a lion. We have such few left. We absolutely cannot afford to lose one if it ingested some plastic. So we said, let's work with the women to really clean up Samburu and their villages. So we worked with over 200 women from the conservancy we live in. And over a week, we collected over 15,000 pieces of plastic litter, which we sent to Nairobi for recycling. And a lot of the women didn't actually really understand the hazards of plastic and the problems of having this in their villages. Mteli, another very special lady from Sasab village, said to me, I asked, what do you do with all your rubbish? And she says, every time it rains and the dry riverbed flows, all the women would just rush there, throw it in there, and just watch it disappear. And she says, we just didn't really know where it goes. But for us, it was just gone. And so this program was really about educating them about reducing plastic, not throwing it into the rivers, and working with us so we can send it for recycling. We also gave them proper shopping bags, so they don't have to put their sugar and their tea in these plastic bags. This has been a great program, and we're really looking forward to doing more with the women in the conservancy. So this is a very special lady, Mteli, who I just spoke about. And when we started the program, Mama Simba, Mteli said, a lot of the women in my village were struggling during the drought. Every time it's so dry, we're losing our goats because they're not able to survive. Is there a way we can earn some extra income through doing something with lions? And we said, yeah, well, let's work out a way of making these little cool animals bearded lions. And so Mteli worked for about 6 months with Mparasori, the other lady, to develop this first lion. And now we're very excited to be able to sell them on behalf of these ladies so they can earn an extra income. And we do have some outside at our booth. Now, I still can't get over this moment, but a week ago, I was driving through Samburu looking for lions, and we've just had quite a lot of rain recently, which was very much needed. But the problem with a lot of rain means there's so much grass, there's no way you'll find lions. So I had spent about 5 hours driving around looking for lions with Yesalai, one of our warriors who was helping me track and spot. But by 5 o'clock in the evening, we'd found nothing, and I said, all right, let's head home. We had about a 2.5 hour drive to head back to camp. So we had left, we were driving off, and suddenly my phone beeps. And I looked down, and there was a text message. And I didn't really see who it was from, I just quickly read it. And the text message said, I have seen 5 lions at Sierra 4 on my way to town, Mteli. And the first thought in my head was, wow, where were these lions? I've been looking for 5 hours, and now someone's seen them. How frustrating. But then suddenly I realized, wait a sec, who has sent me that message? It's her. It's Mteli, who a year and a half ago couldn't write, she couldn't read, she knew very little about lions, but here she was. She sent me this message. And as I read it, I just couldn't believe it. The phone rang, it was her, and she, all I could hear was, Simba, Simba, Gatun, Gatun, Glow. She was just so excited. I couldn't make out a word of what she was saying. But this is what's been so fantastic about this Mama Simba program. These ladies have got so involved. She has named all these bearded lions. There's a lot of garrets, there's a lot of nanais, a lot of nabalos. She's named them, she talks about them, she now sends text messages about them. And, and that's been it's been so exciting to work with these women. So unfortunately, children in rural Kenya, they have very negative experiences when it comes to wildlife. They get to see the remains of a camel after a lion preyed on it. They get to see a cheetah killing their goats. They get to see wild dogs causing massive destruction in their village. There's nothing positive about their wildlife experiences. We decided about 3 years ago that we've got to try and change this. These children are the future wildlife leaders. They're the future conservationists in Kenya. It's absolutely essential that we invest in the future of these children and get them excited about wildlife. and that's what the Lion Kids camps do. I was only 8 years old when I saw my first cheetah, and it happened to be in Samburu. My parents had taken me on safari. And I never forgot that moment. I think I drove my parents completely crazy. Every day I told them, I want to be a ranger, I want to be a ranger, I want to be a ranger. And they just, I'm not a ranger, but they really supported me to become a conservationist. And it really was that first moment when I saw my first cheetah. So we really wanted to develop this Lion Kids Camp to make it about children's first experiences with wildlife, getting them excited about seeing a lion for the first time, seeing, having a close-up interaction with elephants, really seeing them close up and knowing that they're not going to chase you, that you can see them in their natural habitat. So again, these children live just around Samburu, which is such a famous park. These kids are right there and have never been inside. We take them in, we show them animals, we get to give them positive experiences. They go close up to lions and elephants. We take them on bird walks. We have over 400 bird species in Samburu. These kids need to know that. They need to learn about all these incredible species we have. So we started the program a couple of years ago, and to date now we've had 4 Lion Kids camps. 118 children have passed through our camps, all from the local villages around in Samburu and in Laikipia. We did evaluate this camp as well before we took it further. And again, the results were very positive, showing that these camps were significantly making the kids feel, they all said that if they never saw a lion again, they would feel very sad. And so they really understood their importance of having them in Samburu. This was my absolute favorite moment. This picture was taken about a year ago at our last Lion Kids camp in Samburu. And I had these two little kids right next to me in the car, Saiwana and Ltonos, who are from a little village called Remot, about 20 kilometers away from our camp. And they'd never seen a lion before. And here we were on our game drive into the park. We had called all the guides. We told them, you've got to find us some lions. We have the most important visitors we've ever had. And you've got to show us, you've got to tell us if you see lions so we can bring the kids. And they did exactly that. We managed to have some great sightings. But here we were. Just before we saw a lion, Jeneria radioed me and said, Gorette is on the left, so you know, just tell the kids where to look out. I don't know if you can see him, but he's the big brown thing at the back. Anyway, so the kids are next to me, and I was taking pictures of the lion, and suddenly, so they were, you know, I said the lion's there, and suddenly they went down. This was their first ever lion. They went down and almost went under the car seat, and I was wondering what is going on, and all they did was they just kept whispering, Simba. Simba, Simba. They were so excited. And then they came up again, turned around, and that was their expression. These are the faces of kids who've seen their first ever lion. Pure joy. And so this gives me hope. Because if we invest in these kids, get them excited about lions and conservation and wildlife, they will be the next Jeneria. They will be the next warden of Samburu, the next tour guide. And it's absolutely essential that we invest in these kids, and that's what our program is all about. So with the situation in Kenya, with the numbers of lions disappearing so quickly, I get asked this question a lot. Is there a future for lions in northern Kenya? If lions are being killed so rapidly in southern Kenya, what about the north? And my answer is, absolutely, there's a future. Why? Because it's the local people who are invested in lion conservation. Many years ago, when I used to live in the park, I thought lion conservation was driving along the park and seeing them, you know, on the side of the road, recording their, you know, their presence. Only to realize lion conservation is about the people who live with lions, who share the same landscape. And very quickly when I realized that, I moved out. I started working with the most amazing team. I started off in 2008 with 2 assistants, and now we're a team of 32. The warriors, the elders, they risk their lives to save lions. They're so passionate about it. They're out every day covering close to 15 kilometers on foot, recording information. Where are the lions? Where are the other carnivores? Where are the livestock? Let's make sure they stay separate. They're an absolutely fantastic team, and it's such an honor for me to be able to work with these incredible young men. They're out every day with Jeneria, monitoring the lions. They know them all by face. They can identify every single lion. All the lions have been identified individually. They all have Samburu names, and all the warriors know them. They draw their ears, they draw their whisker spots, and that's how we know the individuals. And this is what they do on a daily basis. And you can tell it's working. Why? Why is it working? It's working because we now have lions living permanently outside protected areas. This lioness Naramat, she disappeared for years and we didn't know where she was. But she showed up one day in the middle of the park and we realized that she'd been surviving outside. And now, 6 months ago, she's come and taken up residence right near our camp, together with this young male lion, Lentim. They both live outside with the people who have accepted the presence of these two lions. And what's so exciting, we have lived in this community area for 8 years. Over the past year, we now hear lions at night. And this is amazing, because we feel this must mean they feel safer here. The people have accepted them, the lions feel safer, and they're more willing to announce their presence. And that's exactly what they're doing. On my last night in camp, just before I came to Nairobi, and then Jeneria and I flew out to come to Chicago, we heard a male lion at 2 o'clock in the morning. And it was Loiwotwa, who was so close to our camp. And I could hear him, and I just thought in my mind, something's working here. The community have accepted these lions. This lion, Loiwotwa, is feeling safe. And here he is, right near our camp. I want to just end by really going through a couple of our successes over the last few years. Our team has responded to over 400 conflict cases, meaning every time any carnivore attacked livestock, our team was there to respond and engage with the community and make sure that no one went out to retaliate and kill those carnivores. Our team has also, over the last couple of years, stopped lions from being killed on 35 occasions, including 7 times just last year. Often it's a lot of dialogue to calm people down, to encourage them and say, don't go after these lions, we need them. They have such an important role to play. And sometimes even physically, standing between lions and the local people. Our population has increased now. We had 12 cubs born in 2014 and they're all doing really well. This is the highest population we've recorded in the last 10 years, is our current population. There's increased tolerance of lions. We're able to see that through our research data that we've collected over the years and through our questionnaires with the community. And lions have returned to community areas. For us, that's huge. That is a big success because it shows that coexistence is possible. Our Warrior Watch program has expanded. We now have 18 warriors working across 4 conservancies. We've also engaged with the resident tour guides of Samburu and trained them so they can also get to know all the individual lions and they can feed that information back to us. So we have 20 trained Lion Watch guides. 118 kids have completed the Lion Kids Camp, and I'm really excited because in August we're going to have a reunion with all 118. I'm not sure how we're going to manage that, but we will somehow. And then, of course, our new program, the Mama Simba program, which really is growing from strength to strength, and we're so excited to see how it develops over the next couple of years. Very new news is we just moved into a new camp about 2 months ago, and this really is showing that we really do have a long-term vision for lion conservation in northern Kenya. We've now got proper roots there. We have proper structures. For 7 years, we lived under tents that kept falling apart, and it was very, very basic. But now we have a proper camp, and that's very exciting for myself and the team. All of the work we do, we have an annual operating budget of just under $200,000. Our impact is huge. We do a lot with very little. We maximize every single cent we get, and it all goes straight back to lions and conservation in northern Kenya. But we cannot do this alone. Our work is not possible. We cannot do it alone. And today I ask all of you to join us, get involved, and make a difference to Kenya's lions and to conservation. We absolutely need you. I want to now introduce you to a very special young man who traveled with me from Samburu. His name is Jeneria Lekilele. He is our field manager who started working with me in 2008. He was very quiet, very shy back then. He barely spoke, actually. It was a very quiet camp back in those days. Now, Jeneria does not stop talking. He is an incredible guy who supervises all the warriors, works with the elders, works with the Mama Simba women, monitors all the lions. The guy does not stop. And the number of times he has saved lions from being killed, he stopped people from going after them. The moment that really stays in my mind was about 2 years ago. There was a very badly injured lioness called Koffa Fett, and we were waiting for the vet to come to treat her, but she had just killed a cow. And as we were waiting for the vet, she was behind our car, sitting under a tree. Two elders suddenly showed up with knives in their hands. They were the owners of the cow. And before I knew it, Jeneria was out of the car. I didn't even see him jump out. And he marched off straight towards those two elders with the lioness behind us. And he said, "You can't kill her. You absolutely cannot kill Koffa Fett. She has a role to play. She is so important in this area." And they listened. He saved her. He's an incredible young man, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Jeneria.
Thank you so much, Shivani. Wow, thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here with you. So my name's Jeneria Lekilele. So I work with the Ewaso Alliance. And I just want to emphasize and to tell you a little bit about my story. I'm a warrior, you know, in my culture. But many years before I began working with the Ewaso Alliance, I used to hate lions because I depend on this livestock. And I don't know what is the meaningful of having lions with my area, you know, killing my cows, killing my goats every day. But the time I've come, you know, like joining a West Alliance and really understanding what is really important about the lions having in my home area. You know, and now I'm very proud to say that, you know, I've given all my cows, all my livestock to my brothers to own them. And I own the lions. Like, lions are my life now. I go off, all I do is to turn back and look after the, you know, the lions. I let them look after their goats, and I go just walking, you know, behind my cows, my cattle, just looking at the trucks and talking to the people. And that is really good. And I'm very proud to say that we have changed a lot of people within my community. They do hate lions because they really doesn't know why they need lions in their home area. And that's why now we have all those demographic groups of people supporting these lions in my home area. And they have seen, you know, how lions are very important. Before that, the lion come from the reserve, where it's really protected. You know, just straight away, the warriors will track and kill them. And that's why the number of lions have really declined. But now from the beginning of having 11 lions from the beginning to 50 lions, you know, that tells me everything is really working within my local people. And to come and say sorry because of, you know, losing lion, you know, that is like more than success to myself as a Samburu warrior. To see, you know, the mama or you know, a woman or a moran to come and say sorry for losing this, you know, animal, sorry to lose Ulrich. And that tells me, you know, there is a hope for lions in my area. We only need that, you know, a support to give my warriors now. Like they have already now, the lions have killed 5 livestock just from when we arrived up to now. They have killed yesterday a donkey. But all my warriors are on the ground, really making sure that, you know, those lions are very safe. They're working like 24 hours, tracking this lion, making sure that no one will ever go and, you know, kill them. So thank you so much for coming, for having me here, and listening to me. So, Ashawalek.
The prey animals that are available, are there enough? Is there enough habitat to support prey animals so that they don't have to eat the livestock?
Yes.
So their main prey is medium-sized antelopes like impala, warthog, especially warthog. They seem to have a preference for them. The problem we've had over the last few years is, especially when we went through a massive drought in 2009. The river was dry for 10 months of the year. We lost a lot of our wild prey population, especially in our area, the Westgate Conservancy. Warthogs, impala, waterbuck, they all died. And we lost our entire buffalo population that year, leaving none. We have none left. And that was a tricky time. And it's taken years for these animals to bounce back and come back. And that we're currently at that stage where most of these animals are back and we're monitoring better numbers. But generally, it's the medium-sized prey that are their favorite, their sort of preferred prey. We do work with other organizations who are on the ground, the Grevy Zebra Trust, who's also a WCN partner. They do a lot of work on rangeland rehabilitation, overgrazing, to make sure that there is enough pasture available for these herbivores. And you know, we work closely with them to try and, because it all fits together. We need the grazing, we need the pastures for the herbivores so the lions have enough food so they don't kill the livestock. So absolutely, it's all linked together. And there is work being done on that, which is great.
Hi, you talked a lot about obviously how kids are a big role in future conservation. And how showing them is very important, showing them the importance of the lions. But how would you say, in Illinois, it might be a little harder, you know, places here, to show them the importance that lions really play in that kind of ecosystem? What would you say would be, what would your advice be to teach kids the importance and how we can get them involved?
Involved in lion conservation or just generally?
Like to teach them the importance of how important lions are, it might be hard to show them kind of if they're just here.
I think a lot of awareness, just a lot of bumping them with information. You know, a lot of people don't really realize lions are in trouble. You know, you see films and documentaries and you see huge prides of lions which are filmed in two parks, Serengeti and Masai Mara. And people think, oh, but lions surely can't be in trouble if you see a pride of 50 lions. But unfortunately, the reality is that's not the reality. The two parks that have lots of lions, it's completely different in other parks. And I think it's getting that message out and getting awareness about, you know, lions are in trouble, you don't get huge prides anymore. This is where the media should be playing a big role, is not showing, you know, great big documentaries of a pride of 50 lions. It should be more about the solitary lions, the individual lions, how they're struggling to survive with local people. That's the story. That's the story that should be told, not the stories of 50 lions in a pride and look how happy they are and all the behavior. That's not real anymore. It was many years ago, back in the day when George Schaller wrote his amazing book on the Serengeti lions. It's just not like that anymore. And I think we all have to get real. We've got to become, you know, we've got to be realistic about what the situation is. And the situation is lions are disappearing. Let's talk about the issues, and let's especially the media, let's really get to the bottom of what's really going on.
Yeah, just to add on that, you know, in my area, you know, like those children, they see negative sides. Even myself, before, like I joined Ewaso lands, you know, I don't know what is happening with lands. You know, I see like one lion, but I think, you know, also, like, you know, looking at the one lion, you know, circling one place, I thought it's like 50 lions. But it's one lion, you know, rotating one bush because it's looking for a place to hide. You know, and those kids, you know, it's very important for them to know that, to understand that lions is very few. And within 10 to 15 years, if nothing will be done with the lions, lions will disappear. Like for those children, half of them have never seen a lion. They have seen trucks. Some have seen, you know, lions jumping into the bushes and kill their goats. But they don't know how many lions are left. You know, what is the main threat? They don't know that we are the threat. So it's good for them to grow when they know that, you know, how can we look after these animals so that we can have for another generation coming.
Thank you. On top of the overall population decline of lions, I've heard a lot about pride males being killed off much more rapidly, and the overall population of male lions in themselves being killed off more rapidly, and their population declining. So I was just wondering if there are any measures targeted towards specifically stopping that.
So stopping male lions from being killed by other lions or by
people? By in general, in their decline.
The general decline of male lions. So male lions, they do actually have a pretty tough life. Especially up in Samburu, they don't really have the support of other brothers or big coalitions of males who can really defend prides and defend territories. So life is a lot more difficult for a male lion, which is why their life expectancy is less anyway compared to a female. A female gets a lot of support from her sisters, and you know, a pride is related females, and so they do get a lot of support through others. Whereas the males, and especially in our area, males actually spend very little time with prides. They're very much solitary. They're very much, you know, covering huge areas to maintain their territories and mark their territories. And they don't do, again, this is what comes back to the media, they don't stay with huge prides of lions and, you know, just wait for the females to hunt and they go and eat. That, I've never seen that. I really think the males in our area, if they did that, they would die. There's no female that's going to feed them there. So our males have adapted to that. They are, Loirish and Garrett, his brother, they are absolutely amazing at hunting. They used to bring down huge animals. They just really were, they were real survivors. And so I think these male lions adapt to the area they're in. So in terms of, they do have a more difficult life. We're actually just starting through our research program. We're starting a research study looking at dispersal of male lions. Because when they are solitary and they're leaving these parks, they're looking for food, they are the ones who get into trouble the most, and they are the ones that are killed. So now we're looking to see how males disperse from protected areas to other protected areas, and what are those important corridors that they need to survive. If we can identify those, we can then take in our community programs. We can take in Warrior Watch, we can take in Mama Simba, work with the kids on Lion Kids camps in these areas where there's corridors. So people can then embrace conservation there, and the male lions have a safety net. They can move from one place to another without being cut off in the middle. And this is very much part of a new study that we've begun just this year.
Question. So are lions like red being monitored more closely now?
Throughout the country, yes. The Kenya Wildlife Service has a national strategy for lion conservation, so they're definitely keeping an eye on the lion population. We're operating in northern Kenya, but there's a lot of projects working in the south, so definitely people are keeping an eye out for the lions. We have to. We can't lose our lions. Kenya is not Kenya without lions, and it's absolutely essential that we keep an eye on them.
Same question he did, but when I see on certain specials of male lions taking over a pride and they kill all the little male cubs, does man ever get involved in whatever reason, and how does that affect lion population? Because it breaks my heart when I see them little cubs getting tossed around and murdered by these bully lions taking over pride.
So that's very much, it's very much nature. So in terms of getting involved, as far as I know, people don't really get involved in that. If you know, it is part of lion ecology. Saying that, we almost saw it in Samburu. We had new males come in 2008, but the females were brilliant. The mothers were so good at hiding those cubs and moving them every single day to different places, and they kept those cubs hidden, and the cubs are still around today. So, you know, we've never seen it. It does happen. Again, this is very much, you know, the documentaries, you see a lot of infanticide, but it's nature, and if we happen to see it, we would not interfere, because it is the way of lion's life. But yeah, like I said, the females were brilliant then. They were hiding those cubs every single day.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. So tremendous work, absolutely amazing work that you guys have been doing. So I have a little two-part question. One is subsidies. Is that like a possibility? Have you ever thought about that, where you reimburse for the amount of animals that are lost? Because it still seems that even with the work that you've been doing, that there's still a high rate of depredation. And then also, it seems that in that first picture you show where that animal was, the lion was killed, that it might have been poached. For example, like lions, their paws and some of their body parts are used in like, I don't know, superstition medicine. And so there's a high monetary value for their parts. And so do you find that as like a major concern for if it's, you could get more money from the valued parts of the lions as opposed to a goat or something like that? So those two things, both reimbursing for loss, and the second one would be, do you see poaching in those areas that you work in?
Okay, so I'll answer part of this, and I think Jeneria will follow up. So the compensation, the Samburu way of life, their culture is very much about looking after livestock. It is their traditions, it's very much their being is about looking after their livestock. And we found, especially in southern Kenya, there were a few private compensation programs that were doing this, sort of compensating for the loss of livestock. This very much does affect their culture, because in a way you're sort of paying to not look after livestock then. You know, you will pay you if you lose livestock to a carnivore, and that really is against what they believe in. They are herders, they do look after livestock. So that's one reason why we don't believe in compensation. We're more about promoting coexistence. Let's stop or preventing conflict. Let's stop conflict from happening in the first place. Let's have better livestock enclosures so lions can't get in or leopards can't get in. Let's work with the herders on better husbandry techniques, which is something we're hoping to do later in the year. Let's stop the carnivores from attacking your livestock, so then they won't be conflict in the first place. And secondly, if it does happen, and this is where he's amazing, they get so angry, but he calms them down. Him, Jeneria, and the team, they calm them down, and they just talk to them about why they should not go out and kill those carnivores. So our work is very much about reducing conflict and promoting coexistence, as opposed to paying compensation for the loss of the livestock. And it fits very much into the Samburu traditions, which is very much what our work is about, very much maintaining their traditional way of life. The second part of your question, Jeneria will probably explain a little bit more about the body parts. We've not found that to be an issue in Samburu yet. It is a concern in other parts of Africa. We're very much aware of it, that the trade in lion bone could be an issue. In this instance with Loy Rish, they cut his head because he had a collar and they wanted to remove the signs of the collar. What they didn't know is we were actually there tracking. So we actually heard the whole thing, and that's why we were able to find him. Otherwise, we'd never have even known he was killed. The skin and the legs, it's part of some traditional values that they have, which Jeneria can probably explain. Did I generally answer? Okay.
Yeah, just to add on that is that, you know, before I begin like working with lions, I see within the community it's lack of education that why they should have lions. But if you put in money into compensation, then they will look as, you know, let me release my cattle so that I can get money. Then you are changing people's mind from their own culture to the side of money thing. Then they won't look after their cows properly. They won't like, you know, they won't listen to you to say that, you know, fence your cattle properly while you're keeping your livestock. So that's why, you know, I've been working, coming to like western side of Kenya to really understand about the compensation thing. And I've seen that there's a project that I've started like compensation. Within a couple of years, you know, the funding like stopped. Then you'll see like people getting angry and just go and kill lions because of that. Mm-hmm. And I said it's not good to put into compensation rather than, you know, teaching them so that they can have like long-term future for these lions, for their generations and generations. Because there is a lot of believing within their culture about the lions, that they can do some of the ceremonies without, you know, lions. So if we put compensation inside and you know, the funding is like over, then these lions will be like finished completely because people will get angry. Then what will happen with all those believings about the lions within my culture? So that's why we didn't, you know, I didn't recommend about, you know, the compensation thing. So I'd rather like, you know, giving them, you know, like the importance of having lions for their generations. Because if you speak to the elders, you know, the older generations, you know, you'll get some interesting stories about lions. But you found that those kids now, some of them have never seen a lion. So what about like 10 to 15 years comes, if we put compensation thing and all that, then that will finish. And then the whole believing of lions will like, you know, be finished. About the legs cutting and the skins, it's just a part of the culture that if you kill a lion, your community or your family will believe that you are a very strong warrior, that you can take your livestock like wherever you want to take it because you can prevent against lion attack. So they cut that as a trophy to take back home and singing. So that was the main cutting thing. So that is what we want, like, you know, to ensure that, you know, if though they have all those believing of culture and killing lions for all this trophy, we talk to Kenya Wildlife Service so that they can deliver all these skin if they want from the old, you know, lions. So if there is a circumcision for the skin, then the Kenya Wildlife Service, we just like say, bring two skins here. Then everyone will have that skin rather than every individual person go and kill lion because of that. So that's why, you know, they kill that and they take that skin. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, this was the last question.